on monkeypox. So permit me, therefore, to welcome Yakubu, and then to hand over to Beno. Beno, if you are ready, over to you. And thank you very much for agreeing to do this. Yeah.
Thank you, Dickie. And I want to welcome everyone in this platform who have spare time to join this meeting at this moment. Again, like Dickie rightly highlighted, you know, at this moment, monkeypox is another issue that the world is facing, in fact, including Africa. And again, for us regulators and other stakeholders, we need to have adequate knowledge on the disease, and again, to be able to see how we can mitigate the situation when it befalls us. So at this moment, this webinar today, AVAREF Secretariat deemed me fit to bring out this topic, and we have two experts in the field that can really give us information on monkeypox, its epidemiology, and the vaccine strategy. So may I welcome the first speaker in person of Dr. Daniel C.P. Câmara, who Dr. Câmara has a PhD in tropical medicine and epidemiology of transmissible diseases with a strong background on statistical modeling. He is currently working as an epidemiologist and data science consultant at WHO AFRO region. So at this moment, I want to give him the floor to present on monkeypox in Africa and epidemiology and its transmission. So Dr. Câmara, you're highly welcome. And at this moment, I open the floor to you. Thank you.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you loud and clear.
Thank you, Dr. Beno. Thank you, Dr. Dickey. Thank you, Dr. Jacqueline. And thank you all colleagues for being present. I would like to thank you for this very nice and very kind invitation to do this presentation today. I would also like to thank very much my chief, who is Dr. Charles Ocott, for giving the opportunity to be here with you today. I hope that this presentation will help you understand a bit better the situation that we have in AFRO, and also to make you come up with questions, because we have lots of questions. And it will be a very good opportunity to discuss about the epidemiology and transmission that we have today. I will share my screen with you. If you could please tell me if you can see it. I'm sharing it now. If you could please let me know if you can see it.
Yes, we can see you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jacqueline. Thank you, colleagues. So let's begin our presentation. It will be about 20 to 25 minutes. So I would kindly like to ask Dr. Jacqueline, or if another colleague could tell me when there's 5 minutes remaining, so I can better control my time, okay?
Okay, I will.
Okay, Dr. Beno, thank you. So let's start. Just a minute. Okay. You can see my screen. It's changed.
Absolutely. We can see it.
Okay. Thank you. I had just an internet spike here. Let's begin with a very brief introduction to situate ourselves. Let me put a laser pointer. So monkeypox is originally a zoonotic disease. It is caused by the monkeypox virus. It belongs to the poxviridae family and the poxvirus genus. It results in a smallpox-like disease. The first case diagnosed in humans was first diagnosed in 1970 in a nine-month-old baby in the old country of Zaire, which is now the Democratic Republic of the Congo. We will refer to it as DRC from now on, okay? Monkeypox, following this discovery, it was seen that it was endemic in DRC. And later it has spread and has been identified in other African countries, but mainly in those in the Central and West Africa. From that time up to today, very, very sporadic outbreaks of infections have been reported in Africa. And it typically originated from contact with wildlife reservoirs, hosts, particularly rodents. This is to remind that this is originally a zoonotic disease, okay? So a few decades later, the first reported monkey case outside of Africa occurred in 2003. These outbreaks were travel associated with very limited secondary spread. And at that time, human to human transmission has been deemed inefficient. And the final genetic analysis suggested that the virus had been circulated undetected for some time outside areas where it has been endemic. And possibly it was masquerading as other sexually transmitted infections, STIs. In Nigeria, before 2017, the most recent case of human monkeypox had been reported in 1978. So fast forward by mid-November 2017, a large outbreak caused by the clade 2A resulted in around 146 suspected cases, from which 42 were laboratory confirmed, coming from 14 different states. This is important, and we will see later how this spread, how this, from this time, from 2017 up to today, how this evolved. And nowadays, we had a very recent meeting where the naming convention of the clades changed to clade one and clade two. The clade two itself is subdivided in clade 2A and clade 2B. And the latter refers primarily to the group of variants that is circulating right now in 2022 global outbreak. So, for you to have a very brief global situation of monkeypox as of this week, as of now, there are 106 member states across all six whole WHO regions reporting confirmed cases of monkeypox. As of September 27th, there has been more than 66,000 confirmed cases, more than 3,100 probable cases, including 26 deaths. So since May the 13th of this year, a high proportion of these cases have been reported from countries without previously documented monkeypox transmission. So this is the first time that cases and sustained chains of transmission have been reported in countries without direct or immediate epidemiological links to areas of the West or Central Africa, okay? You can see here, this is the epi curve, and weekly epi curve seen with colored by the WHO different six different regions. We can see that it had a very steep increasing trend, reaching a peak a few weeks ago. And then we are in these past few weeks seeing a decrease in the trend. So how is the situation in AFRO? Right now we have 11 countries with confirmed monkeypox cases. We've placed this table with the countries with the highest number of cumulative cases above, going up to those with the least number of cases. So you can see that Nigeria, DRC, and Ghana have the highest number of cumulative cases and also of deaths. So far, Nigeria have reported 7 deaths. DRC, none of the deaths have been yet confirmed by laboratory, and Ghana have reported 4 deaths. Cameroon and Sudan are 2 other countries that in Africa that have reported deaths. You can see the CFR in here. So up to today, this morning, we have more than 720 cumulative laboratory confirmed cases and 14 deaths. The CFR for the whole continent is a bit below 2%. What is important to notice in here is that deaths are being revised and they are being thoroughly investigated to understand the high mortality and to also to understand if they have been caused by the monkeypox virus. So these numbers, they are not final. We are yet having lots of cases, might be some deaths in the future. So we are having almost daily updates of these counts in our tools and dashboards, and also about the deaths, which we believe that will be revised soon. So this is now the evolution across time in Africa. You can see here at the left, this is the epi curve for 2022. From the first epidemiological week up to now, the 39th epidemiological week for the 11 countries that have reported. We can see this increasing trend beginning here in April. And you can see these spikes are coming from DRC. And you can see also these in purple, Nigeria and Ghana, they beginning this increasing upward trend. You will notice also a small gap that we have here with, we are getting the data yet of these 2 weeks to understand what happened here a few weeks ago. And you can see here in the center of the screen, the individual epicurves for each of the countries. Please notice the different y-axis for each country showing different magnitudes of transmission and confirmed cases. So we said before that Nigeria, DRC, and Ghana are the top 3 countries with the highest number of cases. Nigeria alone accounts for more than half of the cases that are confirmed right now in the continent. If we sum up the 3 countries, they have reported almost 94% of all confirmed cases. So these confirmed cases are being thoroughly investigated to better characterize and understand these cases, understand risk factors, understand comorbidities and other important epi information for us to evaluate. Also, because we already seen in the beginning of the presentation that this is a zoonotic disease endemic in parts of Africa, there are a lot of questions on the modes of transmission. And these are being investigated right now, including high-level missions that are being deployed to the country, to the countries, to prioritize countries and understand if these are human-to-human transmission or if these are zoonotically acquired. And also a great effort on sequencing to identify the main clades involved in the outbreak. So as of now, this is a partial analysis of the age and gender distribution of the confirmed cases in the continent. data comes from 8 different countries and accounting only for 2022 to understand what is happening in this outbreak this year. You can see a larger number of cases in males, a smaller number of cases in females. When we compare the statistics between males and females, the mean and median age of males are a bit higher. They are older than females. The mean age for males is of 25 years old, the median of 27, while of females is both mean and median are around 20 years old. The interquartile range also shows these displacement. Males are ranging in this interquartile range from 13 to 36 years old, while females are ranging from 7 to 31 years old. And also, how is the clinical presentation of confirmed monkeypox cases? We are using data from 8 different countries. Again, only for this outbreak. I forgot to mention in the last slide, but the countries are Benin, the Central African Republic, Cameroon, Democratic Republic of the Congo, Congo, Ghana, Nigeria, and South Africa. Most of these data have been predominantly collected during the early stage of the outbreak. So as more investigations are being done, we will receive better data, and this might change a little. But you can see that the top symptoms that are reported in the CIFs from the confirmed cases are fever, rash, headache, lymphadenopathy, and dysphagia. So one thing that we believe that high-level missions will also bring and clarify are these investigations to recover line lists and CIFs and do more investigation of these symptoms. Other range of symptoms, they deal with chills, fatigue, lesions, coughing, myalgia, and etc. So let's go through the top 3 countries to understand what is happening as of today, okay? So let's begin with Nigeria. As we saw, this is the epi curve of Nigeria so far. We can see an upward trend in cases. It seems that cases are still rising, a bit different from what we've seen in the global situation, okay? From the first slide. We already saw that Nigeria is responsible for more than 50% of the cases. And as of today, there have been 7 deaths that are being investigated. There are 14 states with confirmed cases so far in Nigeria. 6 of these 7 deaths have been confirmed in 6 different states, showing a dispersion of the disease in the country. The case fatality rate is a bit higher than in Africa. If we try to stratify this data, 6 of these of the states of the country, they are responsible for more than half of the total of confirmed cases. This is account from a few weeks ago, so it might differ from what we are seeing today, okay? But if we relax a bit these stratification, we can see that 8 states are responsible for more than 60% of the total of confirmed cases. And the year of 2022 alone right now has more than the whole 2017 to 2021 period, more cases. So this year that of the outbreak 2022, Nigeria has more cases than the previous 4 years when the outbreak started in the country. So this is a bit of the situation that you can see. You will see this is a flow, a map, an annual map, beginning in 2017, and how the outbreak evolved from 2017, you can see this cluster in this part of the country, very similar to 2018 and 2019. As in 2020, there seemed to be a small decrease in the regions. And in 2021, it was a bit similar, right? But when you see 2022, you see a high dispersion. It is a pattern of great dispersion throughout the whole country. Each of the dots here is a confirmed case, okay, in each of these years. So we've seen that from the initial, the beginning of the outbreak a few years ago, the cases were more restricted to the south and southwestern parts of the country. And then this year, it just dispersed throughout the whole country, okay? And we've seen this dispersion to new regions, it happened a bit fast. So you can see the age distribution in 2022. It is in gray, as you can see here on the left side of the screen. It's the gray bars and the black bars are the counts for 2017 up to 2021. You can see a small increase here in 2022 when compared to the previous years in this 31 to 40 year old category. So it shifts a bit from the previous, from 21 to 30 years old, it shifts a bit to these older categories. And in 2022, we are seeing more older people, more older individuals being infected and confirmed. And here at the right side of the screen, you can see a time series, a monthly time series for each of the years since 2017 up to 2022. You can see that 2022, which is in orange, are this great increase, which is not something related to the seasonality of the disease. You can see this large increase, and it is not related to what happened in other years, showing that this outbreak alone is very important and need to be thoroughly investigated. So this is the situation in that DRC. Now we are changing from Nigeria to the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Okay, this is to bring you also, sorry, to bring you this picture of the situation, okay? So as of today, there has been almost 3,800 suspected cases, including 131 deaths. These are all suspected. These are not confirmed laboratorily, okay? So in here, we are dealing with the suspected cases. This gives us a CFR of 3.5, which is higher than what is the statistics for the whole continent, okay? Out of these almost 3,800 suspected cases, since the beginning of the year, okay, there has been 190 laboratory confirmed cases. So there is a gap in here, okay? We are doing a lot of work with country and with focal points, with country representatives and other several colleagues in the countries to manage and increase laboratory capacity in the whole, all of these countries, okay? In DRC, in 2022, almost 90% of the provinces are already affected by the disease. You can see, let's focus here on the right side of the screen. We can see also since 2019 up to 2022, okay? This is also a map, annual map of suspected cases. We can see it was restricted to this portion of the country, okay? In 2019, in 2020, and also 2021. It seemed like 2019 was very, very important especially here in Bankuru province. And then it started to have less cases. And then in 2022, you can see that it spread to this whole part of the country where we didn't have cases being reported, okay? And an important increase in suspected cases. But when we do this stratification, more than 8 out of 10 cases, almost 87% of the cases are being recorded primarily in 7 provinces, okay? And what we have as of today about the genomic surveillance is that all sequence that are circulating in DRC so far belongs to the clade one, which is more related to the silvatic transmission, the zoonotic transmission, okay? So this, you can see here at the bottom left side of the screen, we have an epi curve. The blue bars are the cases, and this red dotted line is the letality, okay, the fatality. So we have first 2021 and then 2022. We can see when we compare, especially this time where we are right now of the year, this small this important decrease in suspected cases, but in 2022, beginning in around April, as we've seen for the other countries, this upward trend of suspected cases, which we still need to do more investigation to confirm, but you can see this changing pattern, okay? It's like the first semester of the year, it was very similar when comparing both years, but when we come here, starting in April, last year saw a decrease. And then when we compare starting here around April, this upward trend, okay? Showing the importance of this outbreak, this year for this outbreak. And finally, we go to Ghana. There has been 650 suspected cases, and PCR testing of these, all of these suspected cases confirmed 91 cases, okay? We can see the distribution of regions in Ghana. If you see it as that it goes from a very light red to a very stronger red, it means more confirmed cases, districts with more confirmed cases. So far, we have 12 out of 16 regions with confirmed cases in the country. You can see here the greater Accra region, which is zoomed in here at the bottom right part of the screen. It has the highest number of confirmed cases, okay, 55, followed by the central region, which is very near, okay, with 7 confirmed cases. And when we see, when we go deeper and see the districts, the Accra metropolis has the highest number of confirmed cases. It is followed by some municipalities, and you can see the difference, almost 20% showing the importance of Accra metropolis in this outbreak. And these other are almost 6%. These districts, they're all here in the Accra region, okay? So far in Ghana, there has been 4 confirmed monkeypox deaths. They have been reported 2 from the Upper East region here. I believe you can follow the laser pointer, okay? 2 deaths in here, 1 death in the Greater Accra, and 1 death in the Central region. And 39 districts so far have confirmed monkeypox cases in Ghana. Okay, so this is the epi curve, differently from what we've seen in the DRC and also in Nigeria. We can see that in Ghana, at least as of now, there was a peak a few weeks ago, and then this small decline. This might change because of backlog testing of samples, okay? But the same pattern of a majority of males is seen also in Ghana, as we've seen in the as we are seeing in the other countries. More than 60% of the cases comes from males. In Ghana, you can see here the age distribution of the cases. There have been cases in including in newborns. The range of the ages goes from 13 days old up to 67 years old. You can see that the number of males exceeds that of females, which is in blue, in all categories. The greater difference, the largest difference we can note here in this category of 16 to 39 years old, and also from 40 to 59 years old, okay? So to coming to an end of the presentation, the summary is for this presentation, so far 11 countries have confirmed monkeypox outbreaks starting this year up to this week. Most of these cases have been reported in countries that have notified monkeypox cases previously, but some of these countries, of these 11 countries, have never reported cases. As of now, there are several high-level missions being deployed to these priority countries to better understand modes of transmission, risk factors, I understand laboratory capacity, and to investigate other epi links and indicators. And WHO AFRO has been providing all the necessary support to improve and strengthen epidemiological surveillance, laboratory capacity, information management, and genomic surveillance in all affected countries since the beginning. So this is it. I will stop sharing my screen and I will pass the word to the chair, Dr. Ben. Thank you so much for listening today.
Thank you so much, Dr. Daniel. I think you kept your time. And I want to suggest that we take questions after the second presentation. And again, I think we are still good with time. So at this moment, I want to introduce the second speaker to us. The second speaker that will speak, it's Dr. Mark Loeb. Dr. Mark is a professor at McMaster University in Canada, where he holds the Canadian Research Chair in Infectious Diseases. He is an infectious disease physician and a medical microbiologist and a co-director of the McMaster WHO Collaboration Center on Infectious Diseases, Research Methods and Recommendations. He conducts randomized controlled trials on the smallpox vaccine. So at this stage, I want to open the floor and welcome Professor Mark to this presentation. Over to you, Prof.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much for the kind introduction, Dr. Yakuba. I'll just see if I could share my screen. Okay, I think that's set up. Thank you so much. Thank you again. For the invitation. And I'd like to give special thanks to Professor Akinmori and to the African Forum as well. And thank you very much to Dr. Câmara for this wonderful talk about the epidemiology of monkeypox in African countries. It's so important because it's, I've been taking notes furiously hearing this because it's very important and relates directly to what I'm going to be talking about, which is the SMART trial, which is a smallpox vaccine for monkeypox post-exposure prophylaxis, a cluster randomized controlled trial. And it's important also to say that I'm you know, speaking on behalf of many people on a wonderful group of investigators from Nigeria, DRC, Central African Republic, Cameroon, Sri Lanka, Uganda, and members, including Professor Akinmori from the World Health Organization, provide incredible supports for us. So I'll start off just, I'll be very brief about the background because you've heard, outstanding presentation previously, but I'll just re-emphasize that monkeypox virus is an enveloped double-stranded DNA virus that belongs to the orthopox virus genus of the pox family. And many of the clinical manifestations of the infections, including a febrile prodrome and all these other systemic symptoms, followed by rash, are very similar to smallpox illness. And that's, you know, relevant because we are essentially testing a smallpox vaccine to prevent complications or severity of monkeypox. So serious complications of monkeypox include pneumonia, encephalitis, sepsis, and ocular infections. In fact, many others. And as you've heard in a lot greater detail than I'm going to be presenting, that the human monkeypox is known to be endemic in Africa and countries in Central Africa. And there are two distinct clades, as you've heard, clade one and clade two, both in West Africa and Central Africa. And the former in West Africa, at least historically, has been characterized by less severe illness. So the typical presentation, and I'm going to be very brief here because it's more complicated than this, but includes a prodrome characterized by fever, malaise, headache, myalgia, and lymphadenopathy, followed by a skin rash of vesicular and pustular skin lesions that progress over time to become scabs. So my emphasis in this talk is to talk about what we could do to either prevent monkeypox entirely or to prevent the burden of illness due to monkeypox. And there are, you know, there are two main options. One is the use of an antiviral agent known as TPOX or tecovirimat, but I'm not going to be talking about that at all. I'm going to be talking about the vaccine. And the vaccine that's available for post-exposure prophylaxis is the Bavarian Nordic vaccine, which is the modified vaccinia ankara Bavarian vaccine. And there's a really important knowledge gap because the unanswered question is, what is the efficacy of post-exposure prophylaxis with smallpox vaccine to reduce both the risk and the burden of monkeypox in household contacts? And that really forms the basis of this cluster randomized controlled trial that I'll be presenting to you. The Bavarian Nordic vaccine, this modified vaccinia ankara Bavarian vaccine, is a non-replicating smallpox vaccine currently available it's the only one that I would say would be available for a trial that we're proposing. And the safety record to date of this vaccine is, I'd say it's excellent. Most of the common or actually even very common adverse events are actually similar to a vaccine like, you know, for example, influenza. They're local reactivity. There are systemic things like malaise afterwards. But adverse events are extremely rare. And to date, the experience is that it is well tolerated. And importantly, cardiac events, there have been, you know, very rare episodes of tachycardia, like less than 1%. So overall, the profile is actually quite safe. Now, the existing efficacy data is really based on childhood smallpox vaccine because there is no observational or randomized controlled data actually testing the current smallpox vaccine. So the historical data is really looking at epidemiologic studies that have compared unvaccinated contacts of cases to vaccinated contacts of index cases. And overall, if you look at the attack rates here of vaccinated contacts, secondary attack rate of 1.31 versus 9.28 in unvaccinated contacts, these data and other data suggest about an 85% risk reduction in those individuals who were contacts and had been exposed previously, many years ago, to the childhood smallpox vaccine. So the primary aim of this randomized controlled trial is to determine if smallpox vaccine can reduce what we're terming, and I'll go into more detail, what we're describing as the monkeypox burden of illness in exposed household contacts of confirmed cases. So the experimental arm of the vaccine, as I mentioned, is the Bavarian Nordic smallpox vaccine. It's a non-replicating vaccine, and it's been recommended in many jurisdictions now for post-exposure prophylaxis for monkeypox. So individuals, contacts of an index case of monkeypox, if they're seen generally between 4 to 14 days after exposure, are eligible, again, in many jurisdictions, for one dose of this vaccine. So our study design is a multicenter, blinded, parallel group, cluster randomized controlled trial in the household members of index cases of monkeypox. So what we propose and what we're planning is households where one or more persons have lab confirmed monkeypox will be the unit of randomization. Household members will receive either the experimental vaccine, that is Bavarian Nordic smallpox vaccine, as post-exposure prophylaxis, or if the household is randomized to a control vaccine, they'll receive the typhoid vaccine as a control. And the primary outcome will be what we're terming a monkeypox burden of illness in post-exposure prophylaxis and control households. And I'll explain that in a few minutes. So the study design, again, is characterized by an active control, the typhoid vaccine, that ensures benefit to all the participants, whether they're randomized to the Bavarian Nordic vaccine or control, they'll incur some benefit from the trial. And it's also an adaptive design where that really enables modification on emerging data. And that's really about the attack rate. If we have to modify the sample size ahead of time, we propose that we will be doing this. The primary objective is very specifically to evaluate if smallpox vaccine versus controls prevents this RT-PCR confirmed monkeypox burden of illness. So it's important that the primary objective always includes RT-PCR confirmation of monkeypox. And this primary objective is to be evaluated over the first 28 days after randomization. So that is the follow-up period. In terms of eligibility criteria, we're including household members of a person with lab-confirmed monkeypox. We'll restrict the age to equal to or greater than 10 years. And that's an important consideration because although in many jurisdictions, it's felt that the benefits to administration of a post-exposure prophylaxis with this vaccine outweighs any risks in children, there is very limited data in children. So we felt that we would restrict the eligibility criteria to a bit of an older age group. And as you've seen, certainly in some countries, that makes sense. I think the epidemiologic data that Dr. Câmara showed overall, not completely, but I think overall, this seems to me to be a reasonable age cutoff. And the exposure would be within 4 to 14 days of onset in illness in the monkeypox index case. Now, by that, I mean 4 to 14 days, not from the time of diagnosis of illness in the index case, but from their onset of symptoms. So we would exclude pregnancy, breastfeeding, any past serious allergic reaction to any of the study vaccine components. Previous smallpox vaccine, there's a potential participant with that, they would be excluded because you've heard, they would already be protected, so they shouldn't really be randomized. And we'd also exclude potential participants who are receiving another investigational drug or other investigational vaccine. So the study procedures are that consenting participants would be randomized by household, as I mentioned, to the Bavarian Nordic vaccine or to control. We would collect participant demographics, sex, age, comorbidities, selected medications, and of course, over the 28 days, very carefully assess outcomes. And the primary outcome that I've been mentioning is what we're terming monkeypox burden of illness. Now, this is a composite outcome of incidence and we'll call it severity, but maybe it's better to term it burden of illness. One of the challenges with any post-exposure prophylaxis trial is that, you know, it's felt based on earlier studies with smallpox vaccine that if you really want to totally prevent RT-PCR confirmed monkeypox, the vaccine would probably have to be given within, you know, 4 or maybe 5 days of exposure. And that's very difficult actually in a household or any other study. Rates of post-exposure vaccine in Canada and the United States, the mean often is like 10 or 12 days. So it's much longer. It's still felt that there could be a benefit. But I think the benefit of this composite outcome is that if there's a reduction in the incidence of monkeypox with the vaccine, that's great. It'll count towards the primary outcome. But even if there's not, we will actually try to see if the vaccine reduces the burden of the illness. Now, I'm calling that, you know, a severity score, but it's really based on a number of signs or symptoms based on data, actually, from a paper that's actually in preprint. But I think it's a very good paper where they looked at the epidemiology from, I think it was from about 1988, and they derived this score. So we would be using this score. We would be modifying it a little bit based on previously published scores in terms of the number of lesions for a rash, but more or less it would be that score. But we would be using that over the 28 days of the trial. So we certainly will look at RT-PCR confirmation, but it's a composite outcome that includes this incidence and the severity score. And this is just an example of the severity score where a number of points are assigned to the number of symptoms and the number of signs. And so the more the number of symptoms and signs, the worse. I don't know if we could call it severity because we're actually just counting the numbers of symptoms and signs. But personally, I don't think it makes sense to, you know, rate, you know, there might be 50 symptoms or signs and rate all of these on a 5-point Likert scale. And, you know, you'd have to actually determine inter-rater reliability and all that. It doesn't make sense. In other vaccine studies that you know we've done before, we've used severity this way for influenza vaccine randomized clinical trials. So to me, I think this makes sense. And the other thing is there are no validated symptom or severity scores in the literature at all. If anything has been validated, it's this study from the Congo, where they actually looked at their score and they found associations with some predictors of a worse prognosis, for example, altered mental status. So I, to me, it has both face validity and it has some form of validation that doesn't exist anywhere else. So the secondary outcomes, as I mentioned, we would include RT-PCR confirmed monkeypox. We'd look at time to resolution of skin lesions, time to resolution of symptoms, the number of skin lesions. Again, that will be incorporated as well. It'll be categorized, but incorporated in points within the primary outcome. And of course, we would look at individual monkeypox complications that I mentioned before as a secondary outcome. We'd also look at pain, zoster. There's a zoster brief pain inventory score that's been validated, and it just needs to be slightly adapted for monkeypox. We would look at all-cause hospitalization and all-cause mortality, and we're still, we're still tweaking things a little bit with the protocol, but this could be as well look at monkeypox-specific hospitalization and monkeypox-specific mortality. So I think we would add that. In terms of laboratory testing, systematically, the participants with symptoms would get tested for with PCR from blood, nasopharyngeal, and any skin lesions. But even if someone does not have symptoms, we would do this testing at baseline, at day 7, or at day 28. So in terms of statistical considerations, the secondary attack rate is, we base the sample size on, a historic secondary attack rate of 9% in household members. Now, even if that attack rate is a little bit lower, I don't think it would be detrimental to the sample size. There's a relatively amount of flexibility. At first we had included 4 unvaccinated members per household, but because we've raised, originally we had set the age at a lower limit of 2, but we felt it was better to increase that age just because of the lack of pediatric data. So that would be on average 3 unvaccinated members per household. That's based on demographic information from Nigeria, where the average household has 5 members. We'd use an intercluster correlation coefficient of 0.1, which is very conservative. And using the data in the paper from the DRC, we calculated a mean burden of illness score in general. This is of untreated individuals of 4.4 with a standard deviation of 1.7. And we estimated that a sample size of 125 households in each group, with accounting for the coefficient variation of cluster size ranging from 0.4 to 0.6, would give us at least 90% power to detect mean differences of 1 in this burden of illness score with smallpox vaccination versus control. So you can see that we originally estimated our sample size to be 1,000, but I think even at 750, it would be very well powered to show a difference in this burden of illness score. In terms of analysis, we'd use an intention to treat principle, that is, all randomized participants would be included in the analysis from the time of randomization to the first occurrence of the outcome. We would use what's traditionally used for analysis here, a t-test weighted by an inverse variance, where the weights are proportional to the inverse variance of the cluster or household means, and the weighted mean reduction in burden of illness would be reported. This is a flow diagram just to see how the whole thing looks like. So you see the eligibility criteria that I had mentioned. Actually, there's a typo there. I should have changed the age greater than 2 to greater than 10. But those are the number of households randomized and the primary outcome, which is this monkeypox burden of illness. In terms of further secondary analysis, we would conduct a multivariate analysis as a secondary analysis where covariates such as age, comorbid conditions, monkeypox clade are considered when modeling the effect of the vaccine. And we'd use logistic regression adjusted for clustering for binary outcomes. In terms of planned subgroup analysis, we will assess the following variables: the effect of age, sex, the presence or absence of comorbidities, and clade. Now, we have also planned a cohort sub-study where, because we're enrolling index case, it's possible to obtain baseline data and follow those individuals prospectively, obtaining the laboratory samples that I've mentioned before, the serum, saliva, including saliva, nasopharyngeal specimen, and skin swab, and follow up at day 7 and 28, and look at sequencing and PCR products, serum, saliva, antibodies, cytokine and chemokines. If possible, we collect PBMCs. That might not be possible, however. This slide is a very brief schedule of the events, so showing that, you know, we screen for eligibility, informed consent, obtain medical history. We randomize samples are collected systematically at day 1, day 7, and day 28, but there's an electronic diary for signs or symptoms all the way through. If anybody's symptomatic, they get a swab. We record adverse events systematically and, of course, assess outcomes throughout the whole study. The known adverse events of study vaccines would be captured on case report forms. These would be reviewed by the Data Safety Monitoring Committee on an ongoing basis, and they would be included, of course, in a final study report. Any suspected unexpected serious adverse events that are life-threatening would be reported within 24 hours. And as well, you know, there'd be proper reporting of possibly related treatment, related serious adverse events. All adverse events that would lead to any permanent discontinuation of study interventions would be recorded, including the final study report. This is just typical for vaccine randomized controlled trials. Data would be captured on electronic case record form. And of course, all data would be kept secure and the confidentiality of participants would be carefully protected. Data would be validated, managed, and stored in de-identified database on a secure server at McMaster University. Any participant who refuses receipt of the vaccine would continue follow-up assessments as long as they don't want to withdraw, just to maintain the scientific integrity of the study and the intention to treat type of analysis. The study organization would be coordinated centrally through McMaster University, where we have funding to do this trial. We coordinate regular meetings with the primary team, obviously including the coordinating investigators, central research coordinator, and the relevant team members to assess trial progress. And we would go through all the required regulatory considerations and ethics prior to initiation of a study site. Of course, we would need approval from you, from the appropriate regulatory agencies, to conduct the trial in accordance with all the country-specific regulatory requirements. Everything would be conducted in accordance with GCP, privacy, and principles of the Declaration of Helsinki. And then finally, this is the slide of the most important group, the investigative team from Nigeria, DRC, Central African Republic, Cameroon, Sri Lanka, Uganda, and our colleagues at WHO who've been really, truly instrumental in supporting the trial. We are also reaching out to investigators in other countries, including Ghana, to hopefully take part in this study. And that was my last slide. I can stop sharing at this point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. And we appreciate your time. Open the floor for questions. However, if you still feel you want to type on the chat box, you can do that. And at this moment, I want to hand over to Jackie because thank you so much. Over to you, Jackie. Jacqueline, are you there, please?
Yes, I was struggling a bit. Thank you, Benno. And over from as here. Our moderator said, we will take questions now on the two presentations. There is a hand raised. Over to you, Dickie.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jacqueline. And while I'm sure others are also raising their hands, I thought I'd quickly pose a couple of questions to the two presenters. I mean, excellent presentations, you know, fantastic explanation of the epidemiology and transmission as we know it so far, and a great deal of work being done by WHO, you know, in collaboration with the countries. So fantastic, Mark. This clearly is a very well thought of and designed study, which will also, in a way, be an intervention while it's being implemented, which is the fantastic thing about it, that, you know, and given the deaths being reported, you know, if these are true, then this would be an ideal intervention. So first to you, Mark, is that MVA, as you say, has been used widely, you know, and, you know, sufficient safety information. It's actually also a part of a couple of vaccines. I believe it's part of the Ebola vaccine, which has been licensed, a prime booster strategy used in MVA. And I was wondering whether in the DRC, this vaccine has been used, the Ebola vaccine, I mean, how would this then affect the use of the MVA, you know, against monkeypox? And do you have any idea whether, you know, obviously to require further investigation, whether those who previously received the Ebola vaccine, either clinical trials or as part of, you know, response to Ebola, are in any way protected against monkeypox? That's like to hear your thoughts on this. And then to Daniel, fantastic presentation. Daniel, you talked about a slight shift in age to older people. And it will be very interesting to understand whether this is just purely age, and what are your thoughts on this? Is there any possibility of people who are immunocompromised being involved in this current, you know, as you say, epidemic? Because in the past, there's been sylvatic transmission, which has been relatively stable, but then suddenly we get this, you know. Just your thoughts on this will be very, very helpful, as you know, so, you know, our regulators and ethics committees get a better understanding. So these are the two questions I have. Over.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Ankomori. So your question to me was, you know, in terms of whether there's any protection with the Ebola vaccine against monkeypox, and really, to the best of my knowledge, there wouldn't be. You know, it's biologically, it's not, they're very distinct viruses. It would, you know, there's really no similarity. And there's no biological reason for any cross protection. So. The answer is that, you know, the answer is no, that the you know, to prevent monkeypox, one would need the smallpox vaccine. And to the best of my knowledge, there's no contraindication of, you know, receipt of the monkeypox vaccine, let's say, after having received the an Ebola vaccine.
Mark, I meant the specific Ebola vaccine, which uses MVA as in a prime boost, because that contains the MVA component. You think that could alter the situation in the DRC? There's a specific Ebola vaccine which uses the MVA. Okay. In addition, yeah.
Okay. Well, I would follow up with that question, because I haven't seen any data on that. I will follow up with a company for that. I'm not aware that it would, but I can confirm that with the company.
Hello. First of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Mark for this very beautiful presentation, this very beautiful and very important study that is being done It is very important for us to have these results. So once you have this published, please don't forget to forward it to us. We would like very much to know how this is evolving. Just a quick comment before addressing your question, Dr. Dickey, to Dr. Mark, who said that your group are following in Ghana to try to reach out to investigators. Maybe we could, we could try to facilitate this. We could try to make this easier. As of today, there is a high level, one of the high level missions is going to Ghana. Some consultants and investigators from WHO are, I believe, as of now, they are on the plane, okay? So if you need any assistance trying to reach people, you can, come to us and we could try to help you with this, if this works for you, okay? We are available to facilitate anything to help on this.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Câmara. And I have to say your outstanding presentation is extraordinarily helpful for us. That detailed epidemiology just is extremely, extremely important to for us for the success of this trial to better understand the epidemiology of monkeypox. So thank you for both.
Great. And Dr. Dickey, about the question of these slight shift, as of now, we don't have data to give you a more precise answer. I could just comment on that based on my own impressions, and not we don't have any analysis that we could data to run analysis to say something more specific about this, but one of the things that I think that we are trying to strengthen in the countries through our office and all our colleagues, the genomic surveillance would be very important to answer this, because are all of these cases related to the sylvatic zoonotic transmission? Are they from the clade 2B, which is this clade more related to this outbreak? If we could have this data, more precise data on this, maybe we could run and see how this age and gender is behaving, and relate this to the clade, because I don't know, from the top of my mind, I don't know, maybe we could, after investigation and seeing if there has been any travel, because I would believe that older individuals might have more, financial resources maybe to travel and expose themselves maybe to clade 2B infection. And these might be part of these. But as I already said, this is something that we don't have data to justify. This is just a hypothesis. We are doing the part of these missions and all the investigations that we've been doing since the beginning of the outbreak is trying to have more data from all of these cases, understand where they have been, if there has been any epilinks. So far, the countries have been providing us very precise and very important information. But on the individual CFIs of the cases, there is a bit of a lack of data, to understand contact tracing, for instance, which would be very important. Understand their travel history and etc. And also about the immunocompromised people, this is something that we are trying to make to capture in data. understand if there are HIV positive individuals who are being infected and individuals with other conditions that might compromise their immunity. But so far, we have very limited data on these. I think that more capacitation and field investigation will really help us understand how to answer these questions, and also the sequencing. We have been, several countries are having their sequencing results, and but this is not so. This is not done in a very broadly, you know, with much of the specimens collected. So I hope I could answer your question. Over.
Dickie, it seems your hand is raised, or this is an old hand.
Old hand, sorry.
Okay. So with that, we do not have any more questions in the chat. And we also have literally 6 minutes until the end of the allocated time for this webinar. And over to you, Dickie, if you would like to close us.
I think just one more question to the regulators and ethics committees who are listening in. Given that this vaccine has been used, you know, and is not a new vaccine, what would be your considerations for such the use of such a vaccine? I mean, in as described in this, you know, very well designed trial, does it require licensure? I think this is a question that, you know, begs to be answered. So I just wanted to find out your thoughts, Beno and colleagues from the regulatory authorities who are listening in, who are participating. Over. You know, it's not online. Any ethics committees, any regulators want to speak to this, especially regulatory authorities? Any? Jacqueline, do you see a hand?
No, we don't have any hands up.
Okay. All right. So that is obviously something worth considering by the, you know, by the regulators, you know, the use of this vaccine, which is already a licensed vaccine, which has been used, you know, in many various jurisdictions, and it's a part of existing licensed vaccines. So I thought it should be good to get their thoughts. But anyway, let me start by, you know, thanking the speakers, you know, profoundly for excellent presentations, you know, for really, really explaining everything down to the letter to all participants on this call. I want to thank you, both Mark and Daniel, for brilliant presentations. We really, really are grateful. I think the link, the high level missions to Ghana, certainly Daniel, if you can pass on the information for them to get in touch with the investigators, then get, you know, link them with Mark, that would be great. You know, I think it will significantly facilitate this work, and also perhaps also now we know some of the questions that Mark and who are also posing as they prepare to finalize their proposal for the clinical trial. So again, if you could, the team can explore that, that would be great. Let me also thank the participants, all those who managed who accepted the invitation and joined us for this webinar. Thank you very much for the audience, for your interest. We will continue with the series. There are several other webinars lined up by AVAREF, and we look forward to your future participation. Perhaps we didn't advertise this well. We'll do a better job of it next time. I also want to thank my own colleagues from WHO in general, and also from the Secretariat of AVAREF, my colleagues who have worked so hard to get this to happen. I sincerely thank you for the hard work. And we'll continue with the series as we continue to support our regulators and ethics committees. So wishing you the very best of the rest of the day, wherever you are. Thank you so much.